Hi guys, Chris here, back with Intel's NUC. Now this is the Gemini Lake version I'm looking at, but the slightly more powerful one. So this one here has the Pentium J5005, whereas the model I looked at last week is the more weaker version. So this is the quad core, that is dual core, this one right here, and that's the Celeron J4005. So the dual cores is ideal for really, really light tasks, but if you want better multitasking performance and better graphics, you'd go for this model here, which in fact is the one I feel to definitely go for. Now the GPU on this has 50 megahertz more turbo, which may not seem a lot, but it also has 18 executional cores, where this one here has 12 executional cores. So it's a more powerful GPU. The turbo is the same, it's 2.7 gigahertz, but it can hold the 2.7 on four cores there. So it does bolster up the performance. And with heavy multitasking in my tests, I found it actually held up quite well and even let me edit 4K video, which is something that really did surprise me. So for ports, we've got quite a few. We've got four USB 3 ports on this. On the front, you can see we've got one there that's colored yellow. This one outputs power even in sleep, so if you needed to charge a device. The power button also has incorporated within it an IR receiver, so you can get an optional remote for this to control it as, say, a media, tiny little media PC. And you've got two little microphones there too. You can see those little dots either side. Now, if you have a look at the back, we've got an exhaust fan here, so it is actively cooled. There is a fan inside here, but to comment on the fan noise, it is really good. You will not hear this fan. Only if you put your air up to it. Even under 100% load, it does not surpass 80 degrees and it does not have any thermal throttling. And even then, the fan is quite hard to hear, especially if you have this hooked up behind a TV with the included VESA mount or a monitor. You're really not going to hear this fan. They've done an excellent job with the cooling on this one, Intel. Now you see too that on the side we have an SD card slot. This is full speed cards it supports. It's wired up via a USB 3 hub, so you don't have any issues with speed limitations. So you can use the fastest cards out there and you can get really decent speeds out of that. So for storage, we've got a 2.5 inch storage slot, SATA 3 inside. That is it. We do not have mSATA or your M.2 spec SSD slot on this, which I feel is a bit of a letdown. If it had that, it would be great. But Intel wants you to get, say, the Core i5 models and different models if you wanted that slot there. Now you can put an SSD or a spindle hard drive in here, of course that's gonna be a little bit slower, but it all depends on your needs. Now for RAM, you can put either 4 gigabytes up to 16 gigabytes that I have tested. It does work, but it must be double data rate 4 spec, 2400 megahertz. So that's the big improvement with the Gemini Lake, as the RAM speed's gone from 1600, double data rate 3, up to double data rate 4 now, that 2400, so it's a big boost in performance, as you see later on in the review. Now, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail with the unboxing. If you want to see more details on the unboxing, please check out the review of the dual core version. So first, start out with having a look at the CPU. So this one here is faster than the dual core version I looked at. That dual core Gemini Lake, the J4005, that only had two cores with a maximum turbo, the same turbo actually, 2.7 gigahertz, but of course now quad core performance is better. But not only that, there's a big change with the GPU. So the GPU is the UHD graphics 605, so it's 50 megahertz faster, but the main key difference is right here, you can see 18 executional cores instead of the 12. So this is going to help with performance, and it really does show when you take a look at benchmarks, when I will show you in just a second. Not only that, graphics performance in games is the big step up with this particular model here. So one other thing I wanted to point out is I'm running 16 gigabytes of RAM, so that does work, even though Intel's website states 18 gigabytes max. The maximum throughput, the maximum link speed, and this is about what I can get with an FTP file transfer test, is 350 megabits per second is all you're going to get out of this wireless. Even though it is a newer chip with Bluetooth 5, which is great, it's not the fastest one. I would have loved for them to have put a gigabit internet card on here, but that probably would have pushed the price right up. If you want faster speeds, use the LAN port as well, because it's gigabit LAN that this has on board. So benchmarks, I'll just start out here with the Geekbench 4 score. So you can see this is a step up from the J4500 version, which is right here. So that single core score is the same because it's really the same architecture. It's the same turbo as well, as I mentioned, 2.7 gigahertz. But look at the multi-score core difference. So 3,444 on the J4005, and then this goes right up to 5,211. It's still quite a low score. Remember, this is a low-end chip,
And the performance is very similar now to a 2 or 3, well, actually a few years old now, about 4-year-old Core i3s, or the Core M35Y10 that I reviewed some time ago. Now, the big difference in performance is the GPU, as I mentioned, because it's got those extra cores slightly faster. So it gets the dual core version around 8,200, but look at the difference now, stepped right up to 11,164. So that's a really nice increase boost there. Now this score is pathetic compared to a dedicated GPU, of course. This is really, really low. But for the type of hardware this is, this being a Gemini Lake, which is basically like the old Atoms, it's actually not too bad and definitely a huge step up. Now, just like the dual core model, I want to test out the system performance with multitasking and real world stuff. So not a synthetic benchmark. I'm just trying to fill up the RAM right here. So I've got it almost full. Well, I've got 12.4 gigabytes of it full here. And what I'm running at the moment is I've got Photoshop open. So yes, you can do minor edits in Photoshop, but it's not going to be super fast. I recommend at least for Photoshop and Premiere Pro and things like that, you at least have a Core i5 CPU. So you can do basic stuff, you just need a lot of patience really when it comes to Photoshop. And bear in mind too, I'm multitasking really heavily for this particular CPU at the moment. Premiere Pro there I do have loaded, I'll show you more on that in just a second on what you can do with it. Chrome here with many tabs open, and swapping between those tabs you can see is a little sluggish, not the fastest you'll see, and same goes for scrolling speed. You can see a little bit of stutter there, but not too bad considering I am running so much at the moment. I also have Edge open there, and I've got the emulator there compiling shaders, the case shaders there, and that is very demanding on the CPU. So it's handling this real life workload really well. It's just so much going on at the moment, and it is bogging down a little, but it's really surprising me. The performance is actually pretty good because I'm quite a heavy multitasker, and I find that for a Gemini Lake, this is doing particularly well. So I'm going to test out the system performance here. I'm going to load out my website here, see how long this takes, continue on. And just to show you that really that scrolling in Edge is very smooth. So the best browser experience with the Gemini Lake, and just like the Apollo Lake and even the Atoms, is still Edge. Edge still runs the smoothest on these particular chipsets. Now I do have some documents open here. So first up is a spreadsheet I wanted to show you. So this one here runs fine. So this kind of hardware is gonna run your spreadsheets, your docs perfectly fine. If you're gonna be searching massive, huge spreadsheets, then go make sure you go with an SSD as your main drive, because a hard drive will really slow things down. And document edits, it's gonna be perfectly fine for this. So I'm using OpenOffice here and no issues with that whatsoever. You can see I'm still pushing that CPU really quite hard. It's almost maxed out with a lot of things still going on, but I will load Jellyfish right here. So this is a 180 megabit per second 4K HEVC codec file, 10-bit. And you can see a little bit of a stutter at the start, and then that is perfectly fine and smooth, and that is running there at 30 frames. So no issues with that. Same goes for Kodi. Kodi playback is all good. We've got native HEVC codec support. So that's decoded in the hardware. Same with VP9 codecs. Something we've had since the Apollo Lake. Now HDR supports another thing that is doesn't seem to be enabled on this. I think the hardware can clearly, to me, the hardware can do it. But Intel doesn't seem to have this enabled with the driver. So I couldn't get that to work. You can also get Netflix 4K and full HD as well. You just need to install all the codecs and things and go through and use the Windows Store application for Netflix. So really good and reasonable power for a media player. Now for a quick YouTube 4K streaming test. So set it to the 4K setting, which it is actually already on. Enable the stats here. And you can see drop frames, nothing so far, which is good. But normally when you go to full screen, it will... No. Okay. I expected it to drop frames because the dual core model did. So the J4005 will drop a few frames, but this seems to be rock solid. So really good for 4K YouTube streaming. So video editing, 1080p is fine. It's not too bad. The export times are, as you'd expect, quite slow, but I'm editing a 4K clip here. And look at the timeline performance. It's actually so much better than I thought it would be considering this weak hardware. Just give you a playback example.
Stutters, nothing like that.
It's only at half resolution of 4K, but that is working.
You can see I've got it
Fine. Now, I've noticed that sometimes the preview window here will completely freeze up on you. Now, export times, as you'd expect for this particular hardware, is going to be very, very slow. And I'll give you a quick example of what to expect for just about a 1 minute clip. It's going to take about 5 minutes to export 1 minute of 4K. That's the YouTube 4K preset. So I don't really recommend editing 4K videos on this particular hardware, but I just wanted to test it out. Taking a look now at Counter-Strike Global Offensive, and this is 720p, lowest settings, and there's a lot of players on the server. And I feel it's doing alright. This isn't bad at all, considering how many players are on at the moment. Now, if there weren't so many players on, then you see what we're seeing now, about 45 frames per second. So in the first Gemini Lake review that I did, that was the dual core model. I didn't check out any emulators, but I got a lot of comments, people saying, please check out some emulators. So it's just this one I'm gonna check out. So this is the only emulator that I personally run. And this one here is a Wii U emulator. It's called CEMU. This is version 1.11. And you can see at the moment, we're getting around 54 frames per second, 55. That's actually pretty good considering. It does seem a little kind of slow, so you probably have to look at some of those graphics packs and things to help just tweak things up a little bit. But overall, very playable. This one's running smooth. I'll check out now Zelda Breath of the Wild. That one's a lot more demanding, as if that's going to be playable. Okay, so for Zelda, it's not looking good at all. We're only getting like 5 frames per second, so this is really just unplayable. You really do need a dedicated GPU, I feel, for this game, this title. Now, you might be able to tweak things with those graphic packs. I haven't had enough time to test that, so there's probably maybe some lower settings and things you can enable to hopefully boost that frame rate, but, you know, this is just not good. So let's step things up even further now with Grand Theft Auto 5. This is a reasonably demanding title, especially for this chipset considering, and it's doing not too bad. I mean, you can see 16 frames per second. That's really quite choppy and laggy and slow, but I have seen it get up to 30 frames per second. I think it does surprisingly well, again, considering that this is only a Gemini Lake. This is, you know, a low watt processor, the quad core, but this is handling this so much better than the dual core version that I checked out. I mean, the dual core version didn't really have even up to this kind of frame rate. That was struggling. It only got like about 10 or 12 frames per second. Now, if you're interested in the resolution, it's 800x600. And of course, the lower settings, I have not applied any of those scripts. There's some scripts out there you can apply to remove some of the shadows and things like that to boost the performance of it. So you might get it closer up towards hopefully 30 frames per second, but I kind of doubt that. But even so, surprising performance here. This is really good to see that the graphics performance has stepped up quite a bit from the move from Apollo Lake to Gemini Lake. And a quick peek here at Fallout 4. So as expected, very low frame rate. This is on the lowest setting, 720p. You may be able to get some improvements if you can run it at 800x600, lower resolution. But I wouldn't call this playable. It's just too choppy. But still, this hardware, considering, is doing really well to be able to run it with this frame rate. So let's talk about the thermals now. So it barely gets warm to the touch, hardly at all. I mean, I've had this running all night. I left it actually running Grand Theft Auto, just running the whole time. And the temperatures are pretty good. I mean, Grand Theft Auto was on for not the whole 16 hours, but for about 6 hours. And you can see here, the average temperature is 64 degrees Celsius, and it's 79 is the maximum you will see. So this is really good. No thermal throttling. Fan noise is really, really good on this. It's just like the dual core version. So you just hear a tiny little hum. And when it's even gaming, it's a little bit more than just a hum, but it's so quiet. If you have this behind a TV or a monitor, you are not even going to hear it. So perfectly fine to keep this Intel NUC on 24/7, I feel. The cooling is perfect. Now, when we look at the power consumption figures here, so this is the watts that it's used. So maximum wattage is around 16.4. So that's a little bit more than the Apollo Lake that I typically saw. I maxed out that one, at least the N3450, at around about 15. Now, you can probably add an extra watt or two if you plug in an external hard drive, things like that. So maximum, I would estimate to be approximately 18 to 19 watts max that this is going to pull. So very low watt power consumption when you compare that to a normal, typical tower PC with a dedicated graphics card and everything like that.
All right, to wrap up the video, as you're seeing for that, some surprising performance. When you have a look at, okay, the synthetic benchmarks, you see Geekbench 4, oh, that's nothing amazing. That will be horrible. But when you do multitasking and heavy multitasking that I was doing, I was surprised that I could switch between the tabs quite easily, edit videos, and just do lots of things at the same time. Now, that probably is aided by the fact that I was using 16 gigabytes of RAM. So do bear that in mind. Consider that maybe with 8 gigabytes or 4, of course, it's definitely not going to be as good there because it needs more RAM windows. But overall, the performance is good. Now, I've noticed about an increase, depending on what game it is, of up to around 35-30% over, say, the Apollo Lake's graphic performance. Now, the massive difference we're getting, of course, is the RAM speeds, and that is aiding and benefiting that GPU mostly, not really the CPU cores. Now, I did some tests as well, and I noticed that when I ran the, for example, Resident Evil benchmark, that I got a very similar result, around 25 frames per second, versus the 26 or 27 that I got almost on this model here. So that's not much of an increase. But running games like Grand Theft Auto 5 with almost semi-playable frame rates is kind of unheard of with previous generations, definitely with this kind of mini PC. So what is this mini PC really for? I feel it's just for light computing tasks, very light gaming, spreadsheets, make a good little server, very light file server or something like that, and you can keep it on 24/7. It doesn't consume a lot of power. Definitely as a media PC, really good for little media center things. They'll play back all your 4K files, but unfortunately it doesn't support HD. I don't know whether HDR, sorry, is going to be added by Intel or not. Hopefully that's going to be patched, that's going to be changed with a driver update, because this hardware can do it. It's just whether or not Intel wants you to actually be doing that, because they probably want you to buy a more powerful version. So not for gamers. If you're a gamer and you want a mini PC for gaming, then you go for something like the Kaby Lake G. That incorporates AMD Radeon GPU as well with the Intel much faster Core i5s and i7s. So that's one to go for gaming. But for everything else, I think for personal computing for most people, something like this is absolutely wonderful. Now, price-wise, it's not super cheap when you factor in the RAM, and it depends on your configuration, of course. So if what I went for an 850 Evo SSD and then 16 gigabytes of RAM, that pushed the price up to close to about 400 or so US in total. So that's when it starts to get a little bit pricey. Now, for around 328 US, you can get something like this that I got from AliExpress. This has a Core i5-8250U and also has NVMe storage, which is much, much faster. So you can use really fast SSDs in this. And that's a really fast mini PC and a lot better for video editing and things like that. But of course, when you add on the cost of the RAM and the SSD, then it's probably about close to 600 US. So it all depends on what your needs are. So should you still get the dual core version? I don't think you should. In fact, I don't even know why Intel has this dual core version. When the price difference is about 20-30 US, you're so much better off getting the quad core version. That's the one I recommend to go for. I wrote a fantastic little mini PC considering the hardware. Very good thermals, great fan noise, plenty of ports. Just a shame that it does not have an M.2 SATA 3 SSD slot as well in here. This would be then, I feel, a perfect Gemini Lake little mini PC. Thanks a lot for watching this review, and I hope to catch you back in the channel later on with the unboxing and preview of this mini PC here I was talking about, the Core i5 model. Thanks a lot for watching. Hopefully you liked this video. If you did, please give a like and subscribe to the channel as well. Bye for now.